Hi everyone, welcome and thank you for joining us. We will now begin our panel discussion on NREGA assets from Dole Hole to Making of New Rural, which is hosted by TRIF. We have a wonderful set of panelists with us today. Welcome to you all. The event has been designed by Shri Anish Kumar, who is Managing Director at Transforming Rural India Foundation. His areas of expertise include creating business organizations run by poor communities and facilitating participation of smallholder farmers in modern value chains. He has been a member of the Planning Commission Working Group on Disadvantaged Farmers and has been involved in designing of policies on producer collectives. Welcome, sir, and over to you to introduce our panel of speakers for today and take the session forward.
Thank you very much, Roshni, and namaskar to everyone, and thank you very much for joining this session. And this is particularly gratifying amidst such richness and feast of powerful chacha sessions. So your interest in making of new rural is, we are very grateful for that. Naj has chosen this topic with a lot of care and aspiration, rightly so. The government last year spent close to 1,11,500 crores, generating 3.4 billion percentages. This was in excess of the budgetary estimates. And that's the beauty of NREGA program and one of the drivers of exceptional impact that it has created. It is demand driven. So it has a unique ability to bend the rural labor market in favor of poor. And if you have seen, unlike any other item on the union budget, NREGA spend is shaped by, in some ways, shaped by citizen demand and needs. There are some gaps, as you would expect in any large program. But mind you, these set of citizens are among the first claimants on India's resources. They self-select themselves. As we saw during influx of migrants, they self-select in distress. They also self-select in aspiration and see dreams in eyes of communities, both women and men, when we have done planning for well, orchards, poultry sheds, and such economic assets. With the power of resources now placed with Gram Panchayats, first time in India's development history, it is truly, NREGA has truly made grassroots democracy count, and therefore its power goes well beyond the 73rd Amendment. And as is true with anything in life, dil to always mange more and kuch to log kahenge. However, in terms of design, social security and safety net, it is one of the most innovative programs ever thought anywhere. I recall on October 24, 2014, two of India's foremost economists, Jagdish Bhagwati and Arvind Panigrahiya, called MGNREGS, the Act, as the Rural Inefficiency Act. They followed up with another a month later, and actually about 20 days later, with a more powerful headline is Dole Hole. Today morning, actually, someone on a WhatsApp chat, as we were sharing about the session, said this is not in good taste. I couldn't agree more. We draw the session title from this, but this very illustrious source, Jagdish Bhagwati and Arvind Panigrahiya. Their piece in the leading English newspapers in November 2014 was backed by data actually from Bihar, collected by Ravelian and Surjit Bhalla, basically making the point that this is an inefficient policy instrument, sort of deriving from the Washington consensus. And it had also built on, at one end, you know, a very eminent economist, John Tinbergen, and a whole lot. At the other end was our own grannies. The argument, and that's from their, you know, op-ed piece I am quoting. The argument was commonsensical. You actually require two instruments to achieve two goals. And NREGA in its design was seeking to address poverty reduction and asset creation with one instrument. And that instrument was one of public works. And so it was bound to fail. So went the argument. Unfortunately, I was no economist. And as a small development worker and a child, he grew up on the fables from Ramanand Sagar's Ramayana and later Chopra's Mahabharat. I was always fascinated by that arrow, which is split into midair, into multiple arrows, at once killing so many. In the last 27 years, I have been always in search of that quiver full of such arrows. To me, it sounds very efficient and more powerful than the quest that we see in new philanthropy or Gen Z or in business for silver bullet, quick wins, big bets, and other such catchy elevator phrases. When you have one instrument to achieve multiple goals, why not bet on it? Well, I am no patch on Tinbergen, but I know challenges and opportunity of rural India is too complex. With millennia of social subjugation in all forms, gender, class, caste, ethnicity, resource alienation, low and misdirected investments, and a Eurocentric worldview, it's, you know, in many ways mutually reinforcing interlack of multiple drivers. It is truly one of the, not just a wicked problem, actually it is one of the wickedest problem. And I say with a lot of empirical evidences, the people who are looking for those arrowed solutions, championed in many, many, you know, of those seductive session outlines, are inadequate. You need adaptive pathways to solve for many. And in my book, and let me say, and in my experience, actually, Rega has precisely done that. Few that the eminent economists didn't show light on include ending of one, the existing workforce gender normative. I don't know of any one public program with mandated women participation of 1/3 exceeding that continuously across years, or any one public program where the tribal population's workforce participation is almost close to double of their presence in the population. Second is the emergence of local democracy in action. It gives hope to the most polished of naysayers, skeptics, with design lines drawn around shelf of projects, labor budgets, social audits, and also to those very ever hopeful, you know, from a different generation of Gram Swarajis, which first time serious money going into the hands of panchayats. And now with 50% reservation that most states have for women, it's a very potent combination for deepening democracy. Third one is actually contrary to the accepted wisdom of elites. Ironic, as I guess most of the participants tuning in today belong to that 1% know-all elite. Rural communities have proved that they know quite a lot on what needs to be done in rural India, with great ideas on improving individual and collective economic asset, not just for today, but for that mythical seventh generation which sees all. Today, aided by in 2014, we had a very interesting amendment to MGNREGA, which has made MGNREGA at the forefront of India's fight on climate change. And that's not just in those cop-outs in Paris, but in the trenches. Today, it is the largest program globally of water conservation and land development. And my argument is, this is the biggest bet that India has taken on making of new rural. That is, in what I would look at is morphing of rural into places of opportunities, against what we have now of movement of people to the false glitzgen, you know, chimera of cities. So, the film, Hansal's film in 2014, City Lights, depicted it so well. To help us unravel these pathways and also what can be bettered, and I'm mindful that in many enthusiasm, sometimes policy and design tweaks actually changes E to A, and instead of bettered, you have battered programs. So we have to carefully chosen the best minds who have engaged with these issues as your panel. They're true-blooded practitioners with unique vantage positions on public policy and administration, coming from civil society, private philanthropy, and evaluation, you know, vantage positions. Let me quickly introduce the panel. Arvindji is your role model public administrator. I have been in awe since I met Arvindji on a hot summer day on NIRD launch in 2010. This was part of a pre-consultation to what later became National Rural Livelihood Mission. And that day, Julfi was also there at NIRD. He has women collective-handedly shown what's possible, even north of India's, to also have good things. Universalization of women SHGs in Bihar has made that idea with proof of concept and exceptional, you know, on the exceptional swell of social advancements in southern India, the pioneering success of NGOs into, you know, Hugo's truth of ideas whose time has come. Today, you have close to 80 million. And it was, you know, 80 million mobilized into SHGs across rural India. The work at Jivika in Bihar gave confidence across India. He helms the administrative side of rural development in Bihar, and we'll hear his unique perspective on leveraging the power of MGNRGS, women collectives, to transform the social and economic landscape of rural India. It is, you know, Bihar is the most rural state with highest migrants as a percentage of population. In Soumya, we have a human rights democracy activist in government system. She knows how you use levers of public accountability and transparency to public spending, planning, and investments. And the opportunity of rural development spend to deepening democracy and improving rural India. Madam Wali, just a day back, I had a most inspiring conversation in your office. She is, you know, very fondly remembered for her work as collector in Mandla. In a short stint, she transformed Mandla, which was awarded as the most improved infrastructure district. And if you are familiar with, you know, there was one study that one of my professors did, and this was in 2011, and they found Mandla one of the poorest, among the three poorest districts across India. She is an exceptional public administrator recognized for her work on leveraging DBT framework for farm produce procurement. And today, as CEO of Employment Guarantee Council, she has done many innovations to ensure MGNRGS deployment for water conservation activities, inclusion of the Divyang workforce to MGNRGS sites and such like. Julfi and I go together over 17 years since I met him in March 94 and later joined him as a colleague at Pradhan. He is an IIT Mumbai alumnus, which has soiled his hands. And sometimes when I hear these phrases, I do wonder how all productive activities, particularly associated with village life, acquire such unsavory connotations. But he has truly, you know, worked with his own hands. He has worked with farmers directly, has been restlessly pushing, and with a purpose drive, pushing boundaries on development thinking and action, bringing international experience, policy, and academic grounding. Yes, he found time amidst all this to study at Harvard, melding his techno-managerial with the commitment into that Greek word forensis, that is applied practical action insights. One of the most thoughtful of India's most active private philanthropy, Azim Premji Foundation, deeply committed to building and making of new rural. And they have been, you know, and what I said in the development quiver, they understand that the MGN, MGNREGA arrow has that power to bridge many social and opportunity cleavages in rural India. So friends, I ask you to sit forward and be attentive. Use Q&A and chats to engage as in our shared effort to build new rural. My job is quite easy with such a great panel. I'll put the spotlight on the fabulous work that our exceptional panelists have been doing in their respective spaces, so that all of us can learn and carry these specific learning to our world of practice, and maybe also some preaching. So sir, let me start with you, Arvind. MGNRGS, livelihood asset, women collectives, new rural. Your thoughts on the relationships, the cause, effect, and specific ideas that can get all this to work together, the assets to work for better incomes and quality of life. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Anish. Hope you are able to hear me.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Actually, initially, I missed a part of your conversation because the browser was not allowing the audio. So I changed the browser and then joined again. So now I'm able to hear you properly. So it's fine. First of all, I really appreciate the nudge that they are engaging into some fruitful conversation around such development issues, which are very, very pertinent at the moment for entire country. And maybe not only India, but maybe across the globe, because the basic issues involved remain the same in other countries as well. I thank Anish for such a profuse an introduction of mine. I have been lucky and very fortunate to be involved with the program on self-help group in Bihar. At that time, we were just planning and going ahead for a loan from the World Bank to start the self-help group program, and Bihar named it as Jivika. That time we were actually learning a lot from wherever it was done, wherever the best practices were there, from Mairada, from AP, from Tamil Nadu, Kerala, Kudumbashri. So we learned the best practices from everywhere, and we were able to replicate that. I'm happy to share that those days we used to count the number of self-help groups as 50 or 100 or 150. Today, there are more than 10 lakh self-help groups in Bihar, and more than 1.25 crore women are part of that collective. And it's very thriving. I mean, the journey has been actually very remarkable. And if you talk to each of the women who have been involved in this journey, their life story itself is one of the, you can say, the best reward that your work can provide. Many of the women who were not able to come out of their household, very hesitant to talk to strangers and all, now, and also it was difficult to eke out 3 meals a day. If you see today, they have gone to 4 or 5 states. They have intermingled with the women there. They have formed more than thousands of self-help groups on their own. So each story of each of those households, each of those women is truly inspiring. And that is what propels us. This collective I see as a very, very important platform. You can say, like we have very good highways, and we can reach very fast if the highways are good. So these are nothing but, you can say, a human highway to reach out to the poorest, to the last mile. Normally, government programs find it very difficult to reach out to the poorest, to the actual, at least as per their mandate, the actual targets. It's very, very difficult. But now SHGs provide such a platform that everywhere it's very, very easy to reach out to them. Second, we have found that investment in women pays back much more. As women take care of the entire household, take care of the children, and somehow investment in women, and when women start providing the funds to the menfolk for their work, their value within the household, their say, everything changes. And that brings a kind of transformation that is truly remarkable. And that is something, it is to be seen, to be believed. Typically, when you hear from outside, it's very, very difficult to actually feel that this kind of transformation has taken place. And this is something I'm using the words from one of the MLAs who was recently speaking in the assembly and saying that earlier I had no interaction with the self-help group, so I didn't know. But now when I have gone to the field, I'm suddenly truly amazed by the kind of transformation. Now, once this kind of platform is available, it is possible for every program of government which professes or wants to target the rural households, change the rural economy, has the opportunity to tie up with this collective, ride on them, use them, and better target, better achieve their potential outcomes. MNREGA also has a very good potential. One good thing is that it is demand driven. So it is not supply driven. It depends on the whatever is the demand available that is there. But what is the demand available? How do you capture the demand available? The greater voice that has been created through the self-help groups, through their collectives, that is what helps in gathering more demand for MNREGA. And also it helps in making sure that the MNREGA benefits are able to reach out to them in a better way. Bihar has taken many important steps for ensuring that there is better asset creation. And Anish, you yourself said that there have been some changes in MNREGA, and now the focus is more on asset creation. The idea is to provide, not only provide work, but also that is something that some kind of asset should also be there. And that is something that helps in the long run. It also helps the economy as such. I'm also able to share with you that last year, when the many people were coming back during pandemic and lockdown, MNREGA was able to provide a job to quite a few. We tried to reach out to everyone who was willing to work. The asset creation focus is actually helping. The focus on the individual households for providing productive assets is also helping. For example, the farm ponds or plantation in their land, or improvement of their land, or poultry shed, goatry shed, cattle shed. All these things are actually helping a lot to the poor households. So I think this focus is really very important. I don't know, Anish, how much time do I have in this round? Because I recall you had said that only 3 to 4 minutes in each round. So I would like to stop here and come back again when others have spoken.
Thank you very much, Arvindji. And I'd like to build on what you said. As the human highways, and in many ways, they are highways of aspiration, and the way you connected your voice, demand, assets. Wali ma'am, I'd like to hear from you with your experience, because you, at one end, you worked in the districts around this, and now you are leading this effort from this state. Your thoughts.
Good afternoon, everybody. Anish, like I think Arvind sir has already mentioned, that there has to be a synergy which the Act had already foreseen. We know it theoretically, we all are, I mean, as you said, one of the, that 1% who know the Act, who read it, who know the guidelines, but somehow that had to get translated from your dole hole to actual assetization on the field. Like the other day when we were talking together, and you mentioned that MP was leading in terms of whether we started with schemes like Meenakshi Talab, Khet Talab, Kapil Dharakoop, Nandan Phalodyan, which you very well explained that they became replicas of how it was, you know, like asset creation, livelihood generation, and strengthening of the rural economy was to be, you know, like expanded in the rest of the country on the basis of what MP was doing, or what was happening in Madhya Pradesh. But somewhere along the line, I mentioned that day, MP did lose its steam on assetization, and we too did become a little focused on, you know, getting more people or more funds, and basically, you know, increasing our numbers of wage earners. Now we are trying to get back to it. I mean, in terms of asset creation focus, the challenges that I find are happening over here is that MP has a very good model of assetization for the individual category works, whether it's Nandan Phalodyan, and it has, you know, like definitely individual category works also have a lot of benefit, whether you talk about your marginalized population, your women, you talked about gender related issues, because if you talk about the kind of social norms we have, women will not step out to work into, you know, very remote areas of the Gram Panchayat, MP being a very large state. We have large swathes of land which are very wasteland, dry scrub forest, where we do need to work on water conservation issues and community structures, which is the present focus. But when we talk of assetization and tangible livelihood creation or some improvement, I somehow see that, I mean, like in MP, we have some strength which we need to build upon on individual assets and livelihood generation. We can make the women work in their own farms, especially if they're living close by in tribal areas. We can make any individual, you know, like especially old age or disabled people work in their own fields, whether it is creating farm bunds, which we call Mer Bandhan in our local language. Mer Bandhan also has its plus and minus sides. All individual works, though they, you know, come up, build upon a more superior so-called superior variety of agriculture. You know, a farmer may move with field one from just one crop a year into a paddy crop, which could be an irrigated crop. We have its climate sides, you know, how it is not a very climate friendly or a nutrition friendly approach to agriculture. So, I mean, we somehow with these kind of medbandhans, which are extremely popular, which have actually gone into creating of assets and improving livelihood of the villagers in some of the poorest of areas who could not afford two crops a year, who are now getting two agricultural crops a year. But then there's a downside that it has affected their nutritional diversity, their crop resilience, their you know, like climate resilience. These factors go down. Plus, when you're doing paddy, you're also exploiting a lot of groundwater. We have also worked on assets like Kapildhara Coops. So the Kapildhara Coops have definitely transformed the agricultural scene for the poorest marginalized farmers in Madhya Pradesh. And it is still, after I think Medbandhan, the next most popular thing where we provide wells in the farms of the individual farmers, especially the SC, ST, OBC, other marginalized, or whatever are the specified categories in NREGA, you know, those 6-7 categories. But somehow I feel there is a lack of creating assetization and livelihood generation on community assets. I mean, the entire concept of commons, of the village commons, might be very old and maybe very hackneyed, but it needs to be revived in terms of creating community assets for livelihood generation, so that we can handle issues of climate resilience, water conservation, rainwater harvesting, and somehow, you know, like, we cannot have assets which are climate unfriendly, diversity unfriendly, or, you know, I mean, which promote monoculture agriculture into something which is more diverse. So that is where I also look forward to this interaction and see how Madhya Pradesh or the country can go ahead in this direction.
Thank you very much, Valiman. The point that you make on Medbandhan and the point that you make on community assets and commons, particularly an important given the new report on land degradation in India, almost 60% of our districts suffer from that, and the new report from IPCC on the challenge on climate resilience. So thank you very much for making these points. And we are, you know, with Nudge, we are working in UP with the MGNRGS with Nudge support, and very grateful to Nudge for that support. It is an effective model of CSO government partnership. We did it earlier in Jharkhand. And now I'm looking forward to work both with Arvind ji in Bihar and you in MP. We are really looking forward to work together. Changing track, Soumya, if I were to now come to you to, you know, examine the role that MGNRGS and women collectives, as Arvindji put it, the human highways of transformation and a natural, power to bring out voice of the marginalized. From your perspective, how do you see this deepening democracy and through that, articulation of voices and leading to better assets, both individual and collective, if you could share your perspective. You have to unmute. No. No, Soumya. Technology is, Murphy has to, and I keep telling everyone Murphy will always come. The only way to save ourselves from Murphy is to go to the nearest temple and put Sava Rupiya ka Prasad. So we are still unable to hear you. Let me come back to you and and go to Julfi. We'll come back, and I would like your perspective on how deepening democracy leads to this improvement in assets. But Julfi, if I were come to you, and I would like to build on APF's exceptional work on COVID response and the most quoted data now. It's a first round of APU survey of 20 to 30 million Indians pushed into poverty. And given the severity of the second wave and the health impact, now I guess the numbers would be close to 400 million. I'll request your reflection in two parts, Jilfi. A is the impact on women's economic empowerment that you see. Women have been at the front line, both at home and also, and you know, on COVID combatment. So, and there is this increase of unpaid care, domestic load on women. Many surveys have indicated that. There are now good estimates that pandemic has induced dip in women's income and labor force participation. Maybe, and many estimates are indicating it would not bounce back to the earlier levels. We haven't seen this dip in the women participation in MGNREGS. So, and if you were to look at this MGNREGS to address the gender poverty gap and emanating from foundation's work on COVID.
I'm saying, like you said, Anish, the labor participation rate of women, as you said, in NREGA is not something that significantly went down. But it's because of the overall crash of the informal sector, urban informal sector, and even in the rural areas, which has created this and the increased burden on women on, you know, local health care and family care and other burdens. Connecting it as to how NREGA can revive or address this situation, I'm not sure if we can find direct equivalence, but my sense is that, you know, the central objective of NREGS and its core principle is something that we should probably not deviate from, but we can add to others with a certain kind of hierarchy or priority. For example, the right to work idea behind that NREGA is the fundamental one. And I think that needs to be respected, you know, primarily. Of course, it can also, given that you have an instrument and a significantly resourced program of the government, we can in parallel achieve important, you know, social and democratic, let's say, goals of our society as well. And that is anyway part of the letter and spirit of NREGA, how it's supposed to happen, including women's participation in NREGS. And it has actually done very well in various parts of the country. I would say that the whole, the focus on deepening democracy, decentralized, planning is with specifically voices of women and other marginalized communities. That part needs to continue to happen. I think it's a checkered situation today. Our continued goal has to be that these provisions of NREGA, that, you know, the planning happens in a participatory way, that the primacy of Gram Sabha in developing and approving plans is retained. One can add to it something that Arvind just talked about, the fact you have this self-help groups and the village organizations and the federations. Let's say the country has built an important social capital as well as an institutional framework that has allowed women a certain degree of power and also a space to change gendered ideas about what women can do and cannot do. How do we build that for strengthening NREGA's planning is something that we can, you know, emphasize on. And this has to happen beyond CFTs and social activists where they are present. There we do see a lot more of this happening. I'm sure it's happening where NRLM and NREGA are partnering well, but I think that needs to be systematized and a lot of emphasis has to go there. I feel that this the other goal of social justice, where both gender and I think marginalization of other kinds can also be built into, and both the process of planning, process of accountability and transparency in NREGA. The last thing I think Sufia was mentioning about, and you have talked about climate resilience. I think this latest ICC panel report, what they're talking about is probably a extremely dangerous scenario coming, facing all of us, and various parts of India are going to face it in the coming maybe, 2-3 decades. So that's is, I think, an area where NREGA can definitely help, along with, various other programs of the government, to strengthen the climate resilience. We still have 51% of our population dependent on agriculture and, based livelihoods. I'm just thinking about one thought that, like in Bhutan, when they have this human, the happiness index, they have a secretariat and they have a checklist where any program or project, when it goes through, they try and see whether it's going to damage any of the key principles behind their happiness index. Now, to the degree they adhere to it or not is a separate question, but I think they have been pretty good in my interaction with them in the past. I'm wondering whether similarly in RHS, the primacy of citizenship in terms of their right to work becomes, it remains central, deepening democracy and the strengthening of the Gram Sabha process, social justice and equity concerns in terms of whose voices count, whose priority counts, followed by climate resilience and emphasis on, say, local economic development. Can these be part of the principles through which planning of NREGA happens? And it almost works like a checklist with, the highest priority, of course, to citizens and their right to work, which is this. We will need then the systematic framework which allows for the execution of NREGA. I think there's a lot of work that needs to happen on that front. There is local elite capture in lots of parts of India. I think local bureaucracy in many places is not able to honor the key tenets of NREGA. Lots of places, I don't think people believe that they have a right to work. So we got to, plug these gaps by, like the work Soumya and all have been doing through social audits. So grievance redressal mechanisms are put in place. If it is social audits, work demand, access to work, gaps in payment related, delays, can we address these systematically? As a consequence of once the system and these principles are adhered to, a lot of changes that you're talking about, be it, women's empowerment or climate resilience or assets for economic development, will emerge as a out of this. So I think that is where our emphasis should continue to happen. I'll stop here.
Thank you, Julfi. Indeed, the way you talked about the IPCC report and Sunita's comment is telling. She has linked this, our now and, to addressing this with justice. So the point that you make on justice today as we speak has to include our responsibility to climate. And you have given, very interesting segue to go back to Soumya, and I guess the technology has been fixed, to hear her perspective on how the core tenets, in some ways you have created a new manifesto for MGNRGS, sort of a Panchsutra, where we don't deviate from the core tenets and still address the opportunities and challenges of building a new rural. But Soumya, the points that Julfi made, and if you could build on from real life experiences of strengthening democratic accountability, grievance redressal, transparency, and how it has helped in improving access to assets.
Well, so thanks, Anish. Can I be heard now?
Yes.
Glad. So coming back to your question about the entire transparency and accountability framework that's there in the NREGA, the fact that the law says that social audits will happen by the Gram Sabha, it's the first of its kind in any law that was passed in the last 50 years of an independent nation before we got the NREGA. Subsequently, the work that has happened on social audits, some states it's terrible, some states it's excellent, some states are mediocre. But the fact is that since it's there in the law, therefore people have a right to ask. Now, the bureaucracy or the political will very often dictates whether something like social audits would take off or not take off. But my own experience with Andhra and Telangana, and this has been literally from 2006 when the Act came into being to 2021, where social audits have happened every single year consistently. And often I've had, you know, one of the things I feel really bad about is, and I was saying this to someone, very little research has actually happened on the process of social audit, the manner in which it has been scaled up or the manner in which it has brought, you know, it has empowered citizens to be able to ask questions. Most of the focus of a social audit is always on corruption. But and that's what everybody seems to want to focus on. I would say the process of empowerment, that a poor marginalized woman from a self-help group can stand up today and say ki ye paisa mujhe nahi mila hai, maine ye kaam nahi kiya, ya mujhe 100 din ka kaam nahi mila. That kind of empowerment is something that is beyond belief. And I say this not just from my experience with Andhra and Telangana or even say down south, but I've heard a lot from Bihar where friends of ours work, and they say that, you know, the way in which self-help group women engage with the whole social audit process, where there's ownership of that process, where they're willing to ask, it is social capital of a very, very different kind. And I'd actually like to, since you said Dole Hole, I would like to compare two programs, one in Mexico.
This is Honorable Dr. Bhagwati and Honorable Dr. Paniglia.
The concept of Dole Hole, I would like to say here, and I followed this argument for years now, where NREGA has been, you know, ki helicopter se paisa dal do. During COVID, if you did not have the NREGA, people would have, you would have had starvation, death, and literally civil war on hands, because where would people have gone? I found college teachers, private school teachers, private college lecturers coming out to work on NREGA work sites because they've had nothing to, you know, nothing to fall back on. So two very popular programs, Bolsa Familia or Progresa and Oportunidades in Mexico, both these happen to be Dole programs, which are conditional cash transfer. So you send your child to school, you will get so much. I was told by friends who had looked at NREGA and the social audits happening here, and looking at that program, they were comparing the two, and they said that lower, you know, the lower level corruption that went up was huge, because a school teacher would say, "Acha, if I have to give you a certificate that your kids are coming to school, then where is my cut?" You know, someone else would say, "Ki, if you have to come to the health center, where is my cut?" Whereas in the NREGA, when a person takes a cut and the person who's given the money knows that he is not supposed to give that money and comes out publicly and speaks, that corruption is challenged. So I feel that an empowerment program like the NREGA, which has been vilified over the years, seen as, you know, even a monumental failure, I would say is not a monumental failure. It is a monumental success that has protected the poor, protected even the average middle class family, which today is out on the streets because they have nowhere else to turn. And the kind of assets that have been created, it's not just, you know, years ago in the first flush of NREGA, I remember at Anantapur, a very poor woman farmer woman laborer who had a very small land holding said to me that when I asked her, "What do you think is so different about the NREGA?" She said, "Earlier, when I was called to the landlord's land to work, I could not negotiate. It was not just work that he would expect me to do in his land. It was also the allied comforts that he would expect me to serve to him." She said, "We have broken free. Today, no landlord can call me and dictate to me in terms of, you know, how much he or she will pay. I dictate, saying that this is what NREGA pays me. If you pay me this much, I'll come to work. If not, there is a government website. I will go there and work." And she said the empowerment that came with it, that I could demand work when I need work. It's still only 100 days. It's not 365 days. There are still 265 days for the entire agricultural season. This is only 100 days. But the empowerment that that 100 days gave in terms of minimum wage, in terms of protection, in terms of, you know, empowering women, women have started not, who come to work on these work sites, actually use that money to save, send their girl children to school, use it for things that they didn't have purchasing power earlier. I have seen Rajasthan villages where women had to, you know, would stand in line for work when the men migrated. Aaj demand pe kam dena hai. Yes, it's still sketchy. There are parts of India where still there is dadagiri. There is still, you know, a lot of, you know, and that hierarchy will be there in society because we are, you know, we are years and years and years of a system that has permeated through subjugation. Yet the NREGA was not just right to work. The NREGA has been the right to life with dignity. It has been the right to earn with dignity. It has been, people are not asking ki mujhe ghar pe bitha ke khana khilao. They are saying hum mehnat karenge. And I would say anyone who ever says this is a dole hole should spend just 1 hour. 1 hour chodo. 5 minute genti aur fawada pakdo. 40 degree ke garmi mein jaake ek work site mein tum 5 minute kaam kar lo. Main Nobel Prize de dungi. But jo nahi kar sakta hai, वो इसको कहे ये ढोल होल है तो ना तो वो ढोल समझा है ना उसने होल समझा है
मैंने इसको
पार्लियामेंट ही नहीं समझा है
नहीं सौम्या व्हाट अ पावरफुल इनन्शिएशन ऑफ द कोर प्रिंसिपल्स व्हाट जुल्फी वाज सेइंग टेनेंट्स ऑफ यू नो एनआरजीएस इट्स नॉट इट्स इट इज राइट टू वर्क इट इज अबाउट बिल्डिंग एम्पावर्ड सिटीजनरी विद एंगेज्ड स्टेट and working on state capacity simultaneously to provide right to life and right to work with dignity. And no CCT or no direct cash transfers can do any of this. Thank you very much for this very important perspective. Now I'd like to turn to you, Arvindji, for a very different perspective. Given the enormous work that you have done in Bihar, both with the women collectives and now with MGNRGS, and looking at MGNRGS in this is whole with W, starting with W, a whole of MGNRGS approach you have taken in Bihar. I was looking at a very interesting demographic trend, and I come from Bihar, and so it was it evolved in me, this demographic trend. There is this village, a very famous village, Rahari in Darbhanga, with a population of 36,000. This is 2011, and it would 2021, this would increase. And this is, class 3 towns of Kerala would be much less populous. We did some work to look at, these places and uptake of MGNRGS in these, particularly for the A category activities. And I was wondering, from the policy side, what measures could support better transition and better transition to secondary and tertiary and occupations? And in some ways, when we talk of right to life and right to work with dignity, we also need to look at areas where, for example, when the reverse migration happened in many parts, and Soumya so and beautifully and powerfully enunciated that, in many parts the young were not willing to go for Favra, even though the Favra itself was a bit elusive, but they were not willing to go for that, and they returned back to cities where there was no work. It didn't happen at a very large scale, but we did our surveys and we found this happening. So what do you see some policy pivots within MGN? Is I'm not talking about diluting any of the tenets, right to work, right to life, right to work with dignity. So I'm not saying that. But if I just did one calculation I was looking at, and I just picked up few numbers. These numbers, 2011 census, very large villages, and then a census towns and outgrowths. Together, they actually comprise a whole lot of about 4.5 crore households. and 4.5 crore households under rural management and governance. And there the uptake of NREGS is low. And that's a quarter of our rural households. And if MGNREGS uptake was, and you know, say, if there was, I'm not saying that it should be like that, it is a demand-driven program, but on population norms, that's enormous, 25, 26,000 crores. And Bihar is a unique state. If you were to just pick up, you know, 5,000 more than villages, more than 5,000, and if you were to declare it as urban, as the new UN and, you know, World Bank, there is a conversation going on to define urban populations globally with the same definitional standards. Bihar would have a higher urbanization than Maharashtra, which is the most urbanized state, or Tamil Nadu with the largest number of cities. I don't know, what's your take on MGNREGS for these areas? And these areas turning into, you know, morphing of opportunities in these areas?
Anish, first, very good points that you have said. I'll come to those, but let me take off from where Soumya left. I think it was needed that a very strong activist bent be given to this discussion, and that has been given. And I'm actually personally also thankful to Soumya, because she helped Bihar a lot when we were starting our social audit society and the work over here. Social audits have actually been very, very important. And the self-help group women who have acquired such a great voice, they are such wonderful asset for social audit. And social audit societies are not doing audit only for Manrega. In Bihar, they are doing social audit for more than 5 programs, including PDS, Anganwadis, and maybe even Panchayati Raj programs. So this is something which is expanding, and which is social audit and process and social audit society have been created through Manrega, but now they are actually helping with all so many other programs. In Telangana, I was told that there are 21 programs where the social audit is being done. In Bihar also, we are in the process of doing it for 7 programs, and it will definitely increase. One more thing I would like to say, what Soumya said in that context, that the Minimum Wages Act has been there for a very long time, but the minimum wages could never be enforced. The minimum wages were actually enforced only after Manrega came into being. So after Manrega, it was ensured that the labor will not be available cheaply in the rural area. Of course, that did mean that some cost might have gone up, but that's perfectly all right, because the money was going to the poorest households where it was most needed. One more thing that I would like to say in this context is the timely availability of fund and timely payment of wages is also very, very important in Manrega. And in the last few years, they have been very remarkable focus on that. And the timely payment has gone up like anything. Like this year, Bihar, from state government side, we are almost 95-96% on time, doing on time payment. That is within 8 days of the work being completed, all the procedures are completed and it is uploaded for payment. There have been some delays at times from the central government level for release of fund, which actually leads to delay. So whatever, what we have found, that whenever the payments are going on time, the offtake of Manrega is much higher compared to when the payments are not going on time, then suddenly it goes down. And then even when the funds become available, it takes another 2 to 3 months before the demand actually again goes up. So this is something very important, that you make sure that the wages are paid on time. First. Second, equally, the money for material payment should also be available on time, because if that is not there, it's very, very difficult to take new work. And when we are talking about assets, then definitely quite a part of it goes into material and skilled components. So these two aspects are also very important when you are taking up, that the funds should be available and there should be timely release. And it's not that the funds, I mean, many a times it's the various bureaucratic channels which where it gets clogged. So we should unclog all those things. We should simplify the processes and ensure that the funds are available on time. You talked about low offtake of MNREGA in Bihar. Traditionally, it might have been definitely so. Last year, if you see, I recall that Bihar
doing. Sir, I was specifically referring to the census.
I'm coming to that also. Bihar, I think in 2014-15, were around 4 crore man days in a year. And last year, we did around 22.5 crore man days. So Sophia said that the focus on just man days won't be good. But focus must be there on the man days also. If there is more number of man days, the chances that the good quality man days are being utilized is much more. And in any case, 4 crore mandates compared to 22.5 crore mandates, there is no comparison. So funds must be available. And this requires a lot of work on the supply side, on the machinery which is there to deliver. So for any program, we must equally focus on the delivery mechanism. If the delivery mechanism is good, they will be able to ensure that the MNREGA is run as per its original principles. As far as you are saying, in particular villages and all, there also, if you look at the data for last year, generally the program has taken off in a better way. As far as you are saying that what would happen if they are converted into urban areas and no MNREGA is available. So let me. I think there is a need for a MNREGA-like program in the urban areas as well. And this has come out very clearly during this pandemic. There is definitely a need for a program like MNREGA. I'll talk about two, three initiatives which have been there in Bihar. One is there was some talk about climate and all. Also, there was a mention. So, in Bihar, there is a Jal Jeevan Haryali Abhiyan which has been initiated or launched in 2019. The focus is on ensuring that all the water bodies, public water bodies, are encroachment is removed, their inlets are unclogged, they are rejuvenated. And we have had now complete database of all the public water bodies of Bihar at one portal. You can go to Jal Jeevan Haryali Abhiyan portal and you can see for yourself. You can even check for your own panchayats whether all the water bodies of your panchayats are available on the portal or not. And let me just tell you that a couple of weeks back, our own chief secretary was actually not believing that it is actually there on record. So we showed him the entire MIS and he again checked the water bodies in his own panchayats and he could find all of them. So
This is
something which is helping us in finding out new avenues where we could work, where we could take up large work, and a lot of this work, Jal Jeevan Haryali component, is coming from MNREGA. Other programs are also, state government programs are also chipping in, but MNREGA is providing a lot of that. One more thing, let me tell you about the focus on gender. The focus on gender in MNREGA is there from the very beginning. Minimum 1/3 work should go to women. But in Bihar, if you see that last 3 years, every year it's more than 50% work is going to women. The work, I think it's there across in other states as well. The work that a woman has to do in a day for the same wages is less than the work that a man has to do in the same period in a day. For example, in Bihar, it is 65 CFT for men, then it's 57 CFT for women. And similar mechanism is available, I think, in most of these states. Then women SHG members are kept as mates. I mean, they're being as mate, and particularly during COVID time, what we did that we appointed mate for ensuring social distancing and ensuring that the COVID norms are maintained, that they are not exchanging the tools, they are maintaining distance, drinking water facilities available on site, hand wash facilities available on site, these things. So for that, they are also appointed as maids. Then women-headed households are given priority in under MGNREGA work. And there is one more very important thing. There is a program, Infrastructure for Climate Resilient Growth, ICIG program. In Bihar, it's being done in 35 blocks in 10 districts. Some very good models have been created under that program. And I think one good way would be to extend the coverage of that program. That will be very, very helpful. Happiness index, I think what Julfi said, it is very, very important that we must have certain checklists against which we must match every program. And it is very, very important to understand that at times a program may, though actual intention may be to provide benefit, but it may actually do more harm in the long run. And that is something that only hindsight will tell you. Hindsight is the best sight, 2020 vision. So that is something that you will come to know only later on. So providing, maybe making some kind of a checklist against which we measure each program before it is actually rolled out. I think that will be very good. I'll stop here and we'll come back if there's...
Thank you very much, Arvind sir, and also for picking on from where Soumya left and how it has been integrated so well in Bihar and extending beyond MGNIGS in truly and, you know, ensuring democratic accountability and governance. We have a short of time, and I was just wondering, Wali ma'am, across India now we are rolling out the GPDP process. Many states have already commenced training, and there is additional planning component of for the 15th Finance Commission. And because, ma'am, you have engaged with the different wings of the government, if you were to look at integrating MGNIGS into the GPDP process, sort of taking a whole of government approach, we have all these, there is Mission Antyodaya, Aspirational District, there is a framework for Atmanirbhar. And if all these were put together into some kind of a approach of planning, bottom-up planning, and where the TNs that we have talked about now, I have been listing out sort of a new manifesto for MGNIGS that has emerged in our conversation today. What would it look like? A whole of government approach to MGNIGS, looking at all these, the women collectives, the GPDPs, the Mission Antyodayas, the Atmanirbhars, the 15th Finance Commission Awards, all of it put together, what it could look for building rural assets for economic rejuvenation.
You've asked me to almost summarize my entire experience of and the entire chat that we had. I think I'll take a few words of what other respected members have mentioned, like functionality of assets and systematic frameworks. We're already talking of a new, you know, futuristic blueprint. And I very strongly believe that, yes, the right to work with respect and dignity is fundamental, which is why in MP we are still focusing on increasing, you know, like getting everybody into the net of NREGA works. But if, you know, like the kind of acrimony that we face, I mean, you have to see the work that goes on, only then you believe it. People who are involved in it, right down at the field level, or who are touring, who see it, they believe in the power of NREGA, whether it was in during COVID, during migrant labor coming back. But there is a large policy-making think tank people who are probably not seeing NREGA at its root levels. They are probably, you know, like they need to understand that it's, you know, it's five fundamental laid down purpose of the act, and its huge multiplier effect in terms of women empowerment, disability inclusion, or, you know, providing wages to the elderly who have no other resort to, you know, like to fend for themselves, in creating creditworthiness, in improving our, you know, like the bargaining power, which was mentioned by Soumya. And, you know, like there's also an aspiration among people that if they manage to create sufficient assets which are economically linked or market linked, they would probably not want to come back to NREGA. Not that it's not a respectable thing. People happily want to work. Madhya Pradesh has almost 75% of its population, actually 75% of its population, who are active workers. So the net network that the scheme provides is huge. Now, this network can be, you know, like, I'll be very clear about it, can be utilized for its political, you know, aspirations of the outright political groups, because it means you're touching 75% of the rural population of my state. Or we can also utilize it for creating the kind of synergy in terms of market linkages. So I'll go back to the word systematic framework has to change, not change, kind of, you know, like improvise on the existing act. No changes are needed in the, you know, stated goals or aims of the act in providing a respectful right to work for everybody, a relief work, as well as a livelihood, you know, like kind of a net, safety net, security net for livelihood. But it has to move on to including self-help. I personally feel, I mean, that's my take, that self-help group driven planning has to improve. We from a NREGA end tend to, I mean, like NRLM becomes a different scheme. So we are almost, you know, like at the coordination level, at the state level, though we are being headed, you know, like by equally competent officers in other schemes, but then NREGA has to formally go to NRLM to ask for its SHG members to get involved. Whereas there has to be a at the Government of India level, there has to be, you know, a master circular which says that every woman who's part of the SHG has to be necessarily part of the NREGA works. If, I mean, like, unless she says that she doesn't want to work here, you know, like, I mean, it's a demand driven to, I can't say you have to force her to work here. I have to go by the, you know, it's biblical standard that, you know, it is a demand driven work. But unless she says that she doesn't want to work, the SHG leader says that they don't want to work, they should necessarily be involved in the planning, in the creation of the SOP, in the, you know, like all the community participatory exercises, which especially in the northern states in Madhya Pradesh are still pretty weak and need to be strengthened. Then, you know, like SHG is also, it has its own market linkages, but then there are issues of aggregation. If we really are genuine about any kind of a market functionality. So the asset, I mean, individual assets, asset creation, then creation of that asset as a functional asset which can be maintained, you know, over the next period of 5 years or 6 years. So there has, and there is provision in the act, so we can do maintenance of individual assets also. But if they're very scattered, if there is no policy clear, you know, direction to it, that what kind of market linkages we want or what kind of aggregations we want. And this is for the state governments to do. I wouldn't be very happy if the, you know, like the union government gets into what area, what block, what district makes what products. But there has to be a certain aggregation possibility of the quantities we are producing. So, I mean, if we go on randomly doing livelihood assets, it will never work out into a sustainable, you know, market linkage. So that activity too, I would think, I feel cannot be dependent on NRLM alone. We may need an entirely separate policy network or a sub scheme or an, you know, umbrella scheme to figure out how these market linkages would be made. So some aggregation, I mean, we you know, like I can plan that a certain block will do only poultry, or a certain block will do only aloe vera, or will do only neem plantation, but I cannot get them to the market.
As a very important point.
CFTs, yeah. So it can be done through the CFTs and the CFPs, but there's a limit to it. This has to become part of the systematic framework at the Government of India level, and they have to provide guidelines to the state government. And just like there are norms as to how many, you know, like STs should be your worker, your women should be at least 1/3, they are measuring how many people are disabled and are included. Similarly, there should be some kind of a categorization that at least, you know, like we have 65% NRM works. So then there should be at least, say, 50% works which are livelihood related and aggregated to the market. And then there should be an umbrella scheme to back up our support. And it should not be dependent only on CBOs and NGOs to help us out of this kind of, you know, trap that we are in.
Wonderful point. And ma'am, I was speaking with the JS, MGNREGS, the category C works actually talks about the kind of things that you have flagged. And there have been scattered across the country. And actually, you know, because the numerator is such a small number, it becomes 0%. And, you know, if you look at the MIS there, he was quite offended when I said it is 0%. And rightly so, because a lot of work has actually happened around work sheds, aggregation centers, and all. Extremely important. And Julfi, and you know, now, and this is an area of one area of interest that you flagged, and you know, Soumya picked it up so well, that we must not dilute the rights, you know, framework of MGNREGS in terms of life, work, and dignity. And you said, in addition, there could be areas that one could. I'd like to, and you know, understand from your perspective, and you have looked at this in a very comprehensive way, the role that you see for civil society in this framework, emerging framework of MGNREGS. It's 2-3 areas which you specifically think that civil society could take on to, yeah, to improve in a functional way.
See, I would say civil society's role should continue, should continue to be on the demand side work. That's one key area, which is to ensure that the community's engagement in that whole participatory decentralized planning happens well, that the community institutions are able to sort of articulate, collectivize more strongly. That's where they should get involved. They probably should not get involved in trying to do things which functionaries are supposed to do. Don't start doing the mate's work. Don't start, you know, ensuring that what the Gram Sevak is supposed to, the Rozgar Sahayak is supposed to do. Many places it has been found that some of these tasks have been handed over, saying, "Ab aap CFT mein hain, aap isse kyun nahi kar dete? Aap hi daud rahe hain block mein isko, you know, karwane ke liye, work approve karane ke liye, ye sab." That one should stay clear of. I think civil society can play a significant role in, you know, model building and demonstrating at a certain scale how all of this kind of can come together, of course, in partnership with you know, the administration, with the panchayat functionaries as well. So that would be the key thing. I think building perspectives in communities on our society, people are, you know, have been, let's say, marginalized, deprived, and disempowered for so long, that continued work of civil society to strengthen the empowerment of people, being able to bring in the gender dimension that, you know, Anish, you talked about earlier, you know, not just women's participation, but women when they're working as maids or SHG leaders and their participation, and beyond assets, because sometimes a lot of these efforts can also create harm. I mean, we know from literature that the burden of women can actually go up sometimes. So being cognizant of it and being able to address this as well. I think knowledge generation around this, being able to, you know, collaborate with, you know, the government, I think academic institutions as well. Like, we have our university, which has been involved in various studies associated with this, but we could probably be doing a lot more. So being able to generate knowledge, provide feedback and input to the larger system, I think those are areas where we could do a lot.
Thank you, Julfi. And very important point that you make is that civil society should not tread on the role of the mainframe or the duty bearers. And that is something in the process of model building also we should realize. Thank you. We had, you know, promised Roshni that we'll have at least one audience question. And I don't know in a top billing what Roshni has brought in. Before we close, I like that audience question to be put, Roshni, and I'll request Soumya to respond to that. I'm really sorry that, yeah. Yes, Soumya.
The question is, Soumya, given the very low number of days of work under MGNREGS that is provided on an average per household, does it really help families to send children to school, etc., or just helps to stave off hunger and raise wages, both good outcomes? I wouldn't say, so again, the statement that I made was actually from a social audit that we had done years ago in Vilippuram in Tamil Nadu. This was when we were still trying to figure out various models of social audit and help state governments. And I remember one of the women who we asked, "Kya karte ho? What do you do with NREGA wages?" she said that, you know, my husband and I both earn. I used to find it difficult to go very far from home, but now within 5 kilometers from across my house, I can go and work anywhere. And she said that, so when our question to her was, what do you do with the money? She said, earlier I could only send my son to a private school. Now I am able to send my daughter also to a private English speaking school. I don't know if that's a great outcome where government schools have such low, you know, turnout of students, and most students, most parents prefer private schools. But the fact that she said, I can now concentrate on my daughter as I would on my son because I have this extra income, meant something. In many places, so Tamil Nadu, again, you have to see it in the perspective of different places. Tamil Nadu has a fantastic PDS system. They do get, so hunger there is significantly lower than probably, you know, the ability to spend on, say, education or private education. Whereas in a number of places, I would in fact say that we've done miserably in NREJ in ensuring 100 days of work. Very few number of people, and that again is economics, because the more number of people who cover 100 days of work, the more there is going to be nervousness from, you know, policymakers who are passing on money to the state governments, where actively now they are actually saying, ki, bhai, NREJ is not one Akshay Patra, you should provide other forms of employment. But I would say that during COVID, and I will draw my greatest inspiration from the fact that these 2 years of the pandemic, or 1.5 years of the pandemic, have actually proven to everyone, even the naysayers of NREJ, ki bhai ye nahi hota to naya doobti hamari, politically doobti, society wise doobti, aur bahut buri gat hoti.
तो सोनिया, आपने तो इतना सुंदर है ना, इमोशनल हाई पर है ना, इस सेशन को है ना छोड़ा है. आई थिंक वी मस्ट यू नो टेक दिस ऑन टू द नेसेस, एंड देयर इज एविडेंस टू दैट. आई एम गेटिंग It is
which
a lifeline.
Cannot be written off.
Wonderful. And with these, you know, words, and with Roshni's continuously prodding for the last 7 minutes, I would like to thank, you know, Arvind ji, Sophia ji, Soumya ji, and dear Julfi. You know, what a fabulous. I am buzzing with, you know, ideas. I'll gather all this together. I've taken copious notes. And you know, this is an agenda for deeper engagement for all of us in the, you know, government, civil society. And we will take this up in these two states. With Arvind ji, we are just commencing engagement. And with Sophia ji, we are commencing an engagement. So I promise, at least for TRI, we are working in Jharkhand and UP. We'll take these learnings that we discussed today definitely there. And with Julfi, he has that enormous, you know, power to bend action in with a large number of civil society and government players. They are present in, you know, many places. So enormous insights and learning, and full of practical and, you know, wisdom. So thank you very much. And thank you very much, participants. And, you know, apologies, we could not take more questions. But this was such a fabulous, interesting conversation that I got just immersed. So my apologies. Thank you very much, everyone. Thanks a lot. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Absolute privilege to have this panel on. Thank you very much to everyone. And thank you, Anish sir, for a wonderful, wonderful session. Thank you and have a good evening.
Bye.